Hello, hello. Today we're talking about the grief of a lost tooth. Imagine waking up one day, looking in the mirror, and noticing a gap where a tooth once stood. At first, you run your tongue over it, feeling the emptiness. Something once so strong, so essential to your identity, is gone. And though it's just a tooth, the loss lingers. It changes how you smile, how you eat, even how you see yourself. Now, imagine losing a loved one. The pain isn't physical, but it's just real. The absence of their presence, much like the absence of that lost tooth, leaves a void that alters how you experience the world. Today, I want to explore how tooth loss, though seemingly minor, mirrors the emotional landscape of bereavement, and what this teaches us about loss, adaptation, and resilience. Tooth loss and bereavement. It's an idea worth sharing. So one day, went to work and came across a young person who has lost their front tooth. Can you imagine how they may feel or the emotions that they'll be going through? The unexpected loss. For many, losing a tooth happens suddenly, probably through a sports accident, a fall, an unforeseen cavity that couldn't be saved. Just like losing a loved one, sometimes we don't see it coming. One day, everything is fine. The next, there is an absence we don't know how to fill. And what we do when we face with a loss? Loss of our tooth or loss of a loved one? At first, we deny it. We run our tongue over that empty space, almost expecting the tooth to still be there. In grief, we do the same thing. We look for signs of the person, traces of their presence, placing their voice in our heads. The physical and emotional pain. Tooth loss isn't just about the gap, it's about the pain that follows, the aching gums, the sensitivity, the awkwardness of chewing. Similarly, when we lose someone, the pain extends beyond the initial moment of loss. It lingers, shows up in unexpected moments, and sometimes it even changes the way we speak. Have you ever noticed how losing a tooth affects your speech? You struggle to say certain words, adjusting your tongue and lips to compensate. Likewise, grief alters our communication. We hesitate before mentioning their name, unsure of how others will react. We learn to navigate conversations differently, filling in gaps with carefully chosen words. Over time, our body and mind adjust. If the lost tooth isn't replaced, neighboring teeth shift, subtly reshaping the mouth. Our body finds a way to adapt, just as our hearts and minds adapt to loss. But adaptation isn't immediate, it takes time, it takes effort, and sometimes it takes intervention, whether it's a dental implant or therapy, a bridge or support group. We often need to help to rebuild, to regain function, to smile fully again. Tooth loss is often hidden. People get dentures, implants, or simply keep their lips pressed together when they smile. Have you noticed some people never smile in a picture? Or some people you come across, they look as though they're always frowning. It could be they've lost a front tooth and they've lost their confidence. Grief too is invisible. Emotional pain is a pain that you can only describe in your own words. It's a pain that is not physical. When you hurt yourself and you see the scar and the sore, at least it heals, but emotional pain never heals. It's recurring, a moment, a memory. It's just the same as losing a loved one or losing your tooth. Grief too is invisible. return to work. We say we are fine. We try to move forward even when we still feel the emptiness. But here's the thing. Whether physical or emotional, loss changes us. The key is acknowledging it, allowing ourselves to feel it, and taking steps, however small, to heal. What does healing look like? For some, it's a replacement of a tooth. For others, it's learning to live with a gap. In grief, some find solace in memories, while others find comfort in honoring their loved ones in new ways. There is no one right path, only the journey forward. Data. Yes, there is a research paper on this. There is a research paper that took a group of people, a quantity. It was a quantitative research. A quantitative research means they gave questionnaires to participants to find out from them how they felt about losing their teeth. And about 49% of the participants reported feeling having difficulties with their confidence as a result of losing their teeth. And this research was taken by J. Fix et al. J. Fix and other authors took part in this research to find out that, yes, when you lose your teeth, it can have an emotional effect on you based on their quantitative research. And then they did another research, J. Fix et al., and this was on qualitative analysis. They were looking at some of the words that people use after losing their teeth, which I'm going to share with you now. Some experience bereavement. They use the word bereavement. Now, when you look at bereavement, there are different stages of grief. First stage is denial and shock. So you are in a state of shock. You cannot believe that you don't have a tooth. You cannot believe you lost that loved one. Then you go through that stage of anger and frustration. But how could this have happened? And you're upset about it. Then you go through the bargaining and regret, whereby you start thinking of ways that you could have prevented it, what you could have done to prevent it. Then you go through the sadness and the grief. People deal with sadness and grief in different ways. Some people can last for a long time, others are able to come out of it. And it's the same with losing your tooth. And then they come to accept it and find ways of coping with it. With a tooth, you may think of replacing it. But with a loved one, you can never think of replacing the loved one. You can only live with the memories of the loss and how best to honor that person who is gone. So, based on the qualitative analysis that was carried out on those participants who have lost their teeth, it was quite emotional for them. And they used some of the words that are on the screen. They spoke about bereavement. I've just spoken about the different stages you go through in bereavement, which is similar to losing a loved one. Some have complained of a lowered self-confidence. Imagine losing your front teeth and not able to speak or pronounce certain words properly. For example, Mississippi, if you replace your front tooth, you cannot pronounce certain words like Mississippi, or lower self-confidence. So you may come across people who do not smile. They've always got a frown on their face, and you may think, what's wrong? And it's maybe because they are not happy with losing a front tooth, and maybe they don't even have the money to replace it. Others go through altered self-image, so they may not want to go out or socialize a lot. They are so self-conscious of it. And then others feel it's a taboo subject. They don't want to talk about it. But you have to do something about it. It's either you go for a denture or an implant, or you do something, or a bridge to replace the gap in the front to be able to increase your self-confidence. So today, I'm going to share with you some dental tips, and as I believe in this mantra, dental prevention is better than cure. What can you do to prevent tooth loss? If you don't want to lose your teeth, some people have underlying health conditions that if they don't do anything about it, may lead to losing their teeth. For example, diabetics are prone to poor wound healing and losing their teeth rapidly. That's just an example. So if you don't want to lose your tooth, you must do something about it because tooth loss is like bereavement. I remember meeting a gentleman. He was a diabetic, and I was trying to tell him to take good care of his tooth. One listened, the other one did not listen. The one who did not listen, the next time I saw him, it's like he lost all his teeth so rapidly. It was very difficult to cope. And the next time he looked so disheveled, it's like he couldn't care. On the other hand, the other one took what I told him seriously and was able to maintain his teeth for a long time and even had a bridge fitted, a sticky bridge, to improve his self-confidence. So, what are some of the tips? As I always believe in, prevention is better than cure. Number one, brush your teeth twice a day. Limit sweet to meal times because we believe when you eat, salivate a lot, so it's able to wash away the acid. Spit after brushing. It's best to brush twice a day with preferably a fluoride toothpaste. I'm aware some people use other types of toothpaste, but something that will repair your tooth. And also visit the dentist and hygienist regularly. Up in the past, you need to go through the dentist before going to the hygienist. But nowadays, there are hygienists that have opened shops and you can go to the hygienist directly for at least twice a professional cleaning in a year. Because at times you have buildup on your teeth like tartar and calculi, which a normal toothbrush may not get rid of. So it's very important to see a professional to remove all that buildup. And lastly, if you've got your phone on you can go to Play Store or App Store and download NHS Food Scanner app. So this is an app when you download it, your phone be your telephone becomes a barcode reader. And you can go into any shop and scan the barcode of the food, and it will tell you how much sugar is in the food. This works for people who are in the UK. I don't know if it will work for other people in different countries. But if you're in the UK and you download the NHS Food Scanner app and you scan the barcode on the food, it tells you how much sugar is in the food. So, for example, I scanned a yogurt. For obvious reasons, I cannot mention the brand. And I noticed it's got about 3.5 teaspoons of sugar. And then I scanned a big box of cereal. And that cereal had about 43.8 cubes of sugar. That is why we tell people not to snack. When you're having a juice or any drink, use a straw. If there are any nursing mothers here, if you are breastfeeding, after the child has finished, goes to bed and sleep, you can goes to bed and sleep, you can take the breast out of the mouth. I hope you've enjoyed listening, and always remember, intervention is better. Thank you. Losing a tooth and losing a loved one. In conclusion, losing a tooth and losing a loved one. Of course, there are different experiences, but both remind us of something profound. Loss is a part of life, and with loss comes adaptation, resilience, and eventually a new way of being. So the next time you see someone missing a tooth, or the next time you feel the ache of grief, remember, loss is not just about what is gone, it's about what remains, and more importantly, how we move forward, one smile, one memory, one step at a time. Thank you for listening. Thank you. I've shared the dental tips on brushing twice a day with preferably a toothpaste. Limit sweet to meal times, spit after brushing, visit the dentist regularly or the hygienist. And lastly, download NHS Food Scanner app. If you're in the UK and when you go shopping, you scan the food and it tells you how much sugar in the food. So, for example, I scanned a yogurt and it showed 3.5 cubes of sugar. And then I scanned a big box of cereal and it showed 43.8 cubes of sugar. This is why it's best to limit sweet to meal times. For nursing mothers, if you are breastfeeding the baby, as soon as the child falls asleep, please take the breast out of the mouth because breast milk has got sugar in it. And if the child falls asleep and the breast is still in the mouth, it can lead to nursing caries, which is decay of the teeth. Losing a tooth and losing a loved one are, of course, vastly different experiences, but both remind us of something profound. Loss is a part of life, and with loss comes adaptation, resilience, and eventually a new way of being. So the next time you see someone missing a tooth, or the next time you feel the ache of grief, remember, loss is not just about what's gone, it's about the what remains, and more importantly, how we move forward one smile, one memory, one step at a time. Thank you, and always remember, dental prevention is better than cure.